I want to tell you about Sarah. She was 16 years old and she told her parents she was going to an alcohol-free event party with her friends. And so she went off in good faith to enjoy that kind of evening. But it wasn't long before she got there that she realized there was alcohol. And what's more than that, there was drugs on there. And she was freely offered those. And at that very moment, Sarah had to make a decision. She had told her parents this was an alcohol-free event. And immediately she had a conflict of interest, a conflict of conscience. Under peer pressure, what would Sarah do at that moment? Would she say no and resist it? Or would she acquiesce to her weaker self? It's an interesting question because probably many of us can relate to the same sort of circumstances. Let me also tell you about George. He was a real estate broker for many years in the business in his late 50s. He was very successful. And he had a very important client who asked him one day out of the blue to fudge the books, to do a dodgy deal under the alias that it's not going to hurt anyone. And so at that moment, George too had a conflict of conscience. Mind you, this was a very good client. This was worth millions of dollars. And George had that moment of listening to his higher self, but also realizing that he was asked to do something that was morally and reprehensibly wrong under the alias that nobody would know and it would benefit the client. So what would George do? Have you ever been in a situation like that where you've been challenged out of the blue, sometimes not expecting it? I want to talk about these kind of situations that get thrust on us and what we are made of and what we stand on in how we make those decisions in life. Welcome to Message Week. I'm John Klassek, Elder in the Church of God, Seventh Day. And as we explore this subject today, I hope we are strengthened in our own personal resolve when circumstances in life are thrust on us and we know who we are, we know where we stand, we know where to draw the line, and we know what to do. The answer in these kind of situations, of course, lies in what we have made of to begin with, where we're anchored to, who we are, what our hearts are resolved to be. Because otherwise we can be blown around by any wind of suggestion and be affected by it. And sometimes when we've made mistakes in the past, previous experience can be a strong dictator to help us make right decisions in the future. So if you've made a mistake and acquiesced to your weaker self in the past, God's gracious, He will forgive, and He will give you the strength and resolve based on that lesson to deal with the stuff that you probably were ill-equipped with at one stage to deal with. See, sometimes the stuff that we deal with is that the devil is in the detail, and we don't readily realize it. Even in the Garden of Eden, the suggestion was made to Eve that her eyes would be opened by eating of the forbidden fruit. And it seemed good to her. She didn't realize the devil was behind the whole scheme, a mixture of truth and lies, and for the innocent human mind, totally beguiled. So, there's one thing to keep in mind. The devil's method is always temptation. The Lord will test you, but the Lord will never tempt you. But the devil will tempt you. He tempted Jesus on the Mount of Temptation 3 times. And if the devil tempted Jesus, you can be sure He will at least try, to tempt those who are His disciples. And it's very important to know that when Jesus prayed in teaching that His disciples how to pray, and we know the model of the Lord's Prayer, He said, "Lead us not into temptation. Deliver us from evil." And some translations render that, "Deliver us from the evil one." Because that's the reality in which we operate. These are the challenges that sometimes we can be beguiled by. See, when the Pharaoh's army was chasing the children of Israel and they were fleeing from Egypt, from slavery, to the promised land, the devil was in the heart of Pharaoh with all his chariots, all his soldiers, all his armed men. They were out for blood and they were chasing women and children, old and young men, animals and sheep and goats and families, helpless, unarmed, in the desert, hemmed by the mountains against the Red Sea. And the children of Israel were fearful. And they saw the Pharaoh's army and they knew, looking around them, there was a certainty that they were going back into slavery or there was going to be severe bloodshed. And so they cried out to Moses and they said, wouldn't have it been better that we died in Egypt? You've brought us out in the desert to kill us. Listen to what Moses said in Exodus 14, verse 13. And Moses said to the people, fear not, stand firm and see the salvation of the Lord, which will work for you today. Very simple, he said, fear not. Don't, number one, don't be afraid. And sometimes we acquiesce to a weaker self because we're afraid. So the lesson here is don't be afraid. Stand firm and see what God's going to do today. And that's a powerful lesson. Number one, don't be afraid. Stand your ground and let God do what he wants to do. In other words, let God move. Because sometimes we try to micromanage what God might have in mind, and God lets go. And he says, well, if you want to do that, you can do that. Fear not. Stand firm and let God do what he wants to do. And every Sunday school and Sabbath school child knows what happened next. The seas opened, the dry land, the Israelites crossed. Immediately the Pharaonic armies pursued them, and the sea closed. And the Pharaoh's army was gone. And from fear and uncertainty, then you have Moses and Miriam and the children of Israel singing and dancing and praising God. The Lord is my strength, they sang, my song. He's become my salvation. This is my God. I'll praise him. Because that's an extraordinary victory. And that was a song of thanksgiving. A song of thanksgiving, a song of victory. If only we'll wait on the Lord. That's the lesson there. Because sometimes in life circumstances, when we seek our rights rather than righteousness, we work very hard to try to engage in society at some level. For example, we could get involved in, there's nothing wrong with writing feisty blogs or being actively involved as an activist in social media. We can begin protesting in the streets, joining marches and rallies. Perhaps we could stand up with placards outside an abortion clinic saying, we are murdering our babies. Perhaps that might be valid. There are a lot of things that we can take in our own hands, but is that the best way in this society? If we really want God to fight our battles, because if we take the sword, God leaves us to our own devices. There's a powerful lesson for that, because under the terms of the Old Covenant, the ancient Israelites were to go in and destroy the idols and pull down the pagan temples. But under the terms of the New Covenant, in the name of Jesus, we operate totally different. And we'll explore that today, and I hope you understand that, because a few years ago, there was a man, part of the Church of God community, that went to Jerusalem and tried to burn down the Al-Aqsa Mosque. And his reasoning was he wanted to bring on end-time prophetic events. So he's trying to twist the arm of God and circumstance as well as warp biblical scripture to his own advantage. And he ended up in a lunatic asylum. Sometimes in this life, we must stand still, fear not, and trust God to provide. One of the lessons that we can learn from the death and resurrection of Lazarus is that God is never late, he's always on time. Lazarus died, he was buried, and 4 days after he was in the tomb, Jesus turns up. And the Jews said, this Jesus who could open the eyes of the blind, couldn't have he kept Lazarus alive? There was skepticism in their voices. Jesus prayed. He said, Lazarus come out, and a certified dead man walked out from that grave. And many Jews believed on Jesus because of that miracle. Was Jesus late? He seemed late. No, Jesus was on time. No matter what circumstances seem around us, never feel that God hasn't heard your prayers, and never allow the suggestion, probably from the devil, that the Lord is late, that God has abandoned you. He hasn't heard your prayers. Because sometimes God intervenes at the very last moment. He did for Daniel. How do you think Daniel felt when he was thrown into the lion's den and they were hungry lions? God could have prevented him from even getting that far. But God closed the lion's mouths. What about Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego? They said, we will not bow down to your golden image. Even though we have Babylonian names, even though we're dressed with Babylonian clothes, even though we serve under Babylonian civil and military government, we draw the line, we stand firm. Sorry, Nebuchadnezzar, we are not going to bow down to your image. Now, Nebuchadnezzar turned purple with fury. He heated up the metallurgy kilns 7 times their temperature, reflecting his rage. Even the soldiers who took Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego and cast them into the furnace, bound hand and foot, perished in the flames. And as Nebuchadnezzar looked into that furnace, he saw one like the Son of Man, an angelic being, with Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. God allowed those young men to get into the fiery furnace, but God was not late. And the young men said, whether God saves us or whether he doesn't save us, we will not bow down to your image. And some of these biblical stories are there to encourage and empower and strengthen us, so that beforehand, when we face persecution or challenging times, like our brothers and sisters in China currently being persecuted for their faith in Jesus, may God grant them the strength and the courage of mind to say, we will not bow down to the Communist Party. We will stand for Jesus. So these things, over thousands of years, human civilization is the same. The human history has been written in blood, and we know differently, because many times, right throughout history, even prophetically in history in the book of Revelation, the saints are called to patiently endure. What? Horrific, challenging, tempestuous, tribulation-type times. You know, no matter what we see around us, even if it speaks contrary to everything that we might hope for, always trust God. Never fear. That's the lesson. Stand firm in the righteousness of God. The Psalms and the book of Isaiah is replete with exhortations to wait on God, to trust him, no matter what you see around you. Psalm 130, verse 5, I wait for the Lord. My soul waits. In his word I hope. My soul waits for the Lord more than the watchman of the night. So this psalmist is expressing that no matter what, I am going to wait on God. And do you realize that in the bigger equation of the things, the Lord waits on us? Have you ever seen it that side? Isaiah 30 brings it out in verse 18. Therefore the Lord waits to be gracious to you. God is seeking opportunity to extend his grace to you, just like he did with Daniel, just like he did with Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego, and just like the thief on the cross with Jesus. Grace was extended to that dying criminal who repented. God is waiting to show grace to us, and therefore he exalts himself to show mercy to you, for the Lord is a God of justice. Blessed are all those who wait on him. So there's a call for us to wait on God, and God is waiting and watching very intently every moment. Except, you know what Jesus said? The Father knows every hair on our head. He knows every little bird that falls. Never be tempted to think that God has abandoned you, that he's far, he's distant, that he's remote. No, God is hands-on. He is sovereign. In fact, he knows every hair on our heads. That's comforting, and that's strengthening in times of challenging. And you know when God's hand moves mightily in your life? How do you feel when Daniel was brought out of the lion's den the next morning unharmed? How do you feel Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego felt as they were invited back out of the fiery furnace, not smelling of smoke, not singed at all? Isaiah 40 hits on the words in verse 31. They who wait on the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. Do you get the idea that as you see God's salvation hands powerfully in your lives, we can be moved and encouraged and strengthened and empowered beyond our physical strength to give glory and honor and praise to God, our Savior? Jesus Christ is called the Saviour of the world for all who repent. And we can look to him for daily providence in every area. The only strength that we have, in other words, is where our identity is anchored. If our identity is anchored in the Lord, in the strength of Jesus Christ by the power of the Holy Spirit, then no matter what comes our way, we'll be able to face it. If our hearts are set and sealed by the Holy Spirit, then in difficult times we will be able to stand. Jesus gave a parable in Matthew chapter 7 about a house that was built on a rock and a house that was built on sand. And the wind came and the floods came and beat against the house. And the house that stood on the rock, symbolic of Jesus Christ, stood the test of tempestuous times. Needless to say, the house that was built on the sand just perished and fell down. And Jesus said in this parable, the fall was great. Everybody knew that this house did not stand. And we'd like to be like the house that stands on the rock of Jesus Christ. There's a really old song that has the lyrics, on Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. And that's a powerful testimony, true, not only to Matthew chapter 7 and the words of Jesus, but also to life's experience generally. Another chorus, another verse in that particular song says, I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. No matter how you are tempted by your friends, no matter how beautiful that woman looks, or how handsome, beguiling the voice of that man is, don't be tempted by another human being who may be beguiling you from the righteousness of Christ. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. And that's why we sing praises and honor to God, to rehearse in our mind great spiritual lessons that will come to the fore in challenging times. And Jesus says, in this world you will have trouble, but be of good cheer. He said, I've overcome the world. There's another ancient hymn, standing on the promises of Christ my King, through eternal ages, let his praises ring. I'm standing on the promises of God. That's what faith is. Believing what God has promised. We don't see it. It's not evident at the moment, but we believe it and we'll stand on it. We'll live on it. And if necessary, die for it. No matter what we see, the scripture says the just shall live by faith. And faith is not always seeing all the results and all the circumstances all the time. That's how our predecessors in the past who lived victorious lives stand as testimonies for us today. The Apostle Paul addressed a different generation of people a couple of thousand years ago there in Corinth. He said in 1 Corinthians 16, verse 13, be watchful, stand firm in the faith, act like men, be strong. This message is very relevant to the feminization of masculinity so evident in the political correctness of leftist ideology in this society today. Because we don't like masculinity. We don't like men and women marrying exclusive monogamous for lifetime. No, we've redefined marriage. Everything now goes abhorrent sin in the eyes of God. And so Paul says here, act like men in proper masculinity under the subjection to Jesus Christ. Be strong. Love your families, dads and grandparents and brothers, husbands. Set an example of Christ-like sacrifice, because that's what we've been called to. In verse 14, he flavors that with, let all that you do be done in love. The type of love that Jesus calls on us is agape love, self-sacrificial love. To love as we've been loved from above. You know, the folk in Galatia were struggling. They'd achieved and celebrated the righteousness of Christ. And then they were given a false gospel. And so they were being tempted on a different spiritual level to go back to rules and regulations and legalism. And Paul said in Galatians 5 verse 1, for freedom Christ has set us free. Stand firm there, even on spiritual matters where you hear another gospel. And don't submit again to the yoke of slavery. So we are called not to be afraid. We are called not to be weakened. We are called not to be tempted. We are called to stand firm. Stand firm on what? on the sure word of God. See, living in this world, we see, as Christians, as followers of Jesus, a world so departed from righteousness and truth and holiness, to a world of blindness and wickedness and depravity, and that which is holy and true is now made to look wicked and evil. The same was 2,000 years ago in Paul's day. He wrote to those in Ephesus and he said, "The battles that we fight are not physical. They are the spiritual entities in powerful places, deceiving and blinding the hearts of men." But he says in Ephesians 6 verse 10 to those of Ephesus, and it speaks to us today, "Finally be strong in the Lord and the strength of his might." Jesus said, "Apart from me, you can do nothing. You have no life outside of me." And if we are anchored in Christ and we pray every day in Jesus' name, then we have a fighting chance, every chance of coming out victorious in the name of Jesus. "Put on the whole armor of God," says Paul, "that you may be able to stand against the schemes of the devil." And he talks about the helmet of salvation, the breastplate of righteousness, the feet shod with the gospel of peace, and holding the shield of faith and the sword of the Spirit. This is a spiritual battle. So when you're tempted, whether it's like Sarah with drugs and alcohol, whether it's like George and a big powerful monetary deal that he's asked to fudge the figures, where will you stand when you'll face your test? If you stand on Christ with the whole armor of God, you will not compromise the righteousness of holiness and truth for the love of your Savior and your love of your Father. We are called to stand in the truth. Jesus described the devil as one who does not stand for the truth because he was a liar from the beginning and his nature is to lie. And we are called to live in life. One of the great privileges of standing in this life is the privilege of standing before Jesus in the next life. Luke brings this out very beautiful. It's a powerful, extraordinary promise of the righteousness wrestled with in this life to grant us glory, transformed in the very image of Jesus when Jesus returns. Luke 21 verse 34, Jesus said to his disciples, "Watch therefore, lest your hearts be weighed down with dissipation, drunkenness, and the cares of this life. And the day of Christ's coming and the reality of judgment come upon you suddenly." In verse 36, he said, "Stay awake at all times, praying at all times," and he concludes that, "to stand before the Son of Man." What an honor, what a privilege to have fought the battles in this life and in righteousness and in glory to stand justified before Jesus. And so I'm going to close with Paul's word given to another congregation, those in Philippi, when he said, "Therefore, my brothers, whom I love and long for, my joy and crown, stand firm thus in the Lord, my beloved." So I encourage you to stand firm in 2018, in 2019, in 2020 and beyond, until Jesus returns. Stand firm in the Lord and reflect his glory in a world that desperately needs it.